Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your favorite brother from another mother. I don't know why I'm talking low. I've been talking to the Lord, praising His holy name, and He's worthy, brothers and sisters. I just came on here. Just, you know, when you spend time in the presence of the Lord in praise and worship, you know, it makes you, sometimes the anointing of the Lord makes you be still and peace, and the Holy Spirit moves in various ways, depending on what the Lord is trying to do, brothers and sisters. So, like when I make videos where I'm really preaching and stuff, it's the anointing of the Lord is moving for that. But right now, this presence of the Lord is really that is a spirit of peace, brothers and sisters. So I wanted to get on here and make a video for that. And I just wanted to release that on you right now, the spirit of peace from the Lord. And just want to be obedient to Him. Give Him all the praise and all the glory. Let's worship Him right now. Let's praise His holy name. Let's bless His holy name. Hallelujah, Father. Father, we just bless your holy name right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. We love you, Lord. We worship you, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord God. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your grace, Lord God. We thank you for your mercy, Lord God. Hallelujah. Bless your holy name, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. I just release spirit of peace upon your people, Lord God. And Lord, you said your peace you give unto us, not as the world gives you. You gave, Lord, to us, your disciples, your people. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah. And I just release that anointing of peace. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Father. We praise you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Father. We honor you. We praise you, Lord. We just receive your loving kindness. We receive your joy and your peace. Brothers and sisters, you know the Lord really wants you to know that He is with you, even in the valley. There's a song called God on the Mountain. Our God, He's the same as a God on the mountain as He is in the valley. And there's another song by the same group, the McCameys. It's called, Even the Valley is Higher Ground. Satan can't touch me where God's love abounds. Even the valley is higher ground. So brothers and sisters, you know, the God of the mountain is still the God in the valley. The God in the good times is still the God of when we're in bad times. The God of health is also still our God when we have troubles and sickness and trials. That's why we need to bless His holy name. You know, the way out of trouble, brothers and sisters, the quickest way out of trouble, number one, ultimately, is fasting. But sometimes people have to work and all that. They can't fast. Depends on your situation. But the way out of trouble, brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, if you're in trouble, you got problems, you got situations going on, the way out is to praise and worship the Lord. Bless His holy name. Praise Him. Thank Him. You know, I'm thinking of another song right now. It's called I've Got So Much to Thank Him For. I tried to sing it before way back in a video. It goes like this. If I can do it, the Lord is leading me. I'm just so, the peace of the Lord is so strong I can't even hardly speak. So praise His name. And as you're watching this, I'm come in agreement with me, and I believe that the Lord is releasing that anointing on your peace. Hallelujah. Praise His name. And the song is, I've got so much to thank Him for. Let's see. When I think of what He's done and where He's brought me from, I've got so much to thank Him for. And when I reach Sweet heaven's door, and there let me kneel once more. For you see, he's been so good to me. Hallelujah. I know I'm getting the verses backwards. It's been years since, I first heard that song when I first started in the ministry. I started out in a Mission Baptist church in the Appalachian region here of North Carolina. So they have all the old hymnal songs, which were inspired by God. And then those other kind of songs, like what I was just singing, a folk Christian song. And praise God for every kind of genre of music, brothers and sisters. I want to tell you something while I'm talking about it. I know I mentioned this before way back. Never, never reject a style of music. Never reject a style of music. I want to say this. There's young people watching this who don't want to hear hymnals. There are older people here that don't want to hear some kind of rock music, Christian song, different kind of things. And even rap Christian. There's even Christian rap and all that kind of stuff. But as I'll give this sort of a testimony. Now, you know, I started out as and was an assistant pastor in a Baptist church, as I just mentioned, and they sang the hymnal songs and these songs like what I was just singing, sort of Southern gospel and folk Christian songs. When I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit in March of 2001, I wasn't satisfied with that. I thought was the music, but it's actually not the music that wasn't satisfying me. It was the anointing of those singing it that wasn't satisfying me. I wanted to receive anointed singers, see, and a lot of you might not know this. That's why the Lord is even to tell you this. It's not the music, because all of those Christian songs, basically, you know, nearly 100%, I'm sure there's some that are not, but nearly 100% of all Christian music was inspired by God to be made for somebody to hear and enjoy, whether they like to listen to bluegrass or rap, rock, country, any kind of piano, hymnal style, whatever, a cappella, any kind. And so we all have the type that we like. You know, for me, as a matter of fact, really the ultimate worship is really a cappella music, like some of the a cappella hymnal music that I play sometimes on my videos in the background. And because, you know, the music can be a distraction. Lots of times they play the music too loud and you can't hear the words and et cetera. Anyhow, so it's not the song, as long as that song came from the Lord. It's the anointing of the singers and the worshipers and yourself that affects the spiritual enjoyment of that song. So it's not about our natural enjoyment, not even some can sing, if someone can sing good or not. It's the anointing that attracts us, and that anointing is the Spirit of God. And what attracts the anointing, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. So it's our worshiping him, spirit-filled people, in worshiping him, as Jesus said in John chapter 4, when we worship the Lord, Jesus said God is a spirit, and we should worship him in spirit and in truth, not in Jerusalem or in Samaria. He was talking to the woman at the well in Samaria, and she was asking, where should we worship God, in here or in at the temple in Jerusalem? And Jesus said, in neither place. The time is coming and now is when God is a spirit and God wishes people to worship him in spirit and in truth. So when you worship God from your spirit to his spirit, you know, your spirit is bearing witness that his spirit has saved you. Then God responds by sending down his anointing, a physical manifestation of his spirit. And that's when you get miracles, signs and wonders. People, people being convicted of sins and wanting to repent, to be born again, to rededicate their life, to walk in sanctification, holiness, for people to receive the baptism, Holy Spirit, to be physically healed, mentally healed, emotionally healed, all those things comes from the anointing of God. But we are ministering to him with praise and worship. Praise and worship is ministering to God, and preaching is God ministering to us, and the presence of his Spirit during praise and worship and preaching is him ministering to us, drawing us to repentance, healing, as I just mentioned, salvation, all those things. And so anyway, I didn't know that what I just told you. You know, that's the difference between a mentor and experience. If someone mentors you, you know, you can save yourself 10 years worth of trouble if you allow the right person to mentor you And so really that's what a pastor is supposed to be doing, our elder, is mentoring people in the things of God. So if people who are wise and listen to people who are anointed and elders in the church, they can save themselves a whole lot of heartache and trouble by, you know, learning the hard way through experience. A mentor is a shortcut to experience. You can accept the wisdom of other people. Like if I wanted to know how to become a billionaire at real estate, I probably wouldn't ask a preacher or a doctor or a lawyer. I would probably ask Donald Trump as an example. You know, so we have to go to someone, whatever it is. In this case, of course, we're talking about the Lord. We're talking about Christianity. We're talking about walking with the Lord. Of course, the place to go is people who are more experienced at us than us walking in the Lord. That's how, you know, learning begins with humility. And I would say that's probably, I'm going back to my other topic in a minute. The biggest thing it's the same topic I'm talking about. The Lord is just correcting me because we're talking about it receiving from God through different forms that aren't conventional for us. And that's where humility comes in. This is even a broader topic as the Lord is giving me the wisdom right now and opening up my understanding and wisdom here to a higher level. Thank you, Lord. You know, this thing applies to people who are resistant to receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. People who, you know, in those old mainline Protestant denominations they don't even believe the Bible is the literal, inerrant Word of God. And then you get like Baptists who believe the Bible is the perfect, inerrant Word of God, but yet they have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, you know, the Holy Spirit in operation outside the Bible, outside of the life of the apostles, what they call secessionism. So they believe that God has ceased and desist with the gifts of the Spirit since the last apostle died. So anyone that came from this doctrines and stuff, you know, it's a matter of humbling ourselves and then we can be mentored to go to a higher level in God. So the example that the Lord gave me in this video is about worship music. So myself, when I was new, of course, I've always been a truth seeker, and that's why God baptized me in the Holy Spirit. That's why, you know, of course, it's my faith and all that, too. But the Lord put me in the ministry and, you know, predestined me for the ministry that I have because the Bible says whom he foreknew, he did predestine. So God knew, he foreknew in advance what I would say yes to him. He knew what I would and wouldn't do, and he predestined a life for me. And the same thing for all of us. He knew we would get saved. He knew you would be baptized in the Holy Spirit or not. And he knew all those things. He predestined your life for what he knew you would respond with. So anyhow, I didn't know, because all the gospel, Southern gospel singers I'd ever met and hymnal singers were all, you know, unanointed people. Slightly anointed. Some of them had a little bit, 10%. I never really ran into any, I don't know why I made that assumption, but I assumed that, hey, if it's a Southern gospel song or a hymnal song, it's going to be, I mean, it's, you know, the words are nice and it can be a blessing to you in the natural, but it's not a mighty move of the Spirit in those songs. You know, and like I told you at the beginning of this, the truth is, if God inspired the song and you have a Holy Spirit breathed on, inspired is the word we use in English, someone is God breathed through them as a vessel, as a singer, an anointed, people might say, is the other word, anointed. The charismata, that they've had the oil of God rubbed on them, as I talked about in my last video. That's where the word comes from, charismata, anointed, we say in English, or inspired by God, breathed on, inspiration, like when you breathe out, it's inspiration, breathed on, God breathed. And a God-breathed song with a God-breathed on singer, doing it from their heart, not as a show. That's another thing. I've met Pentecostal people, Spirit-filled people who were showmen, about half fake show-offs and showmen. There's lots of people like that too. And then when they sing, you know, there's some anointing, but you can also, if you're, you know, have that discernment or even just looking at them, you can see people sometimes put on a show also. They're entertaining people and not the Lord. So when we preach, like what I'm doing right now, teach, really is what I'm doing right now, teaching, or if you preach, or if you sing, or whatever you do, do it to the glory of God. You sing for a one-person audience, and that's the Lord, not for any people, not to please people, not to entertain people. That's the secret to the anointing is, when I do this, is as unto the Lord, for the Lord, for his glory, to please him only. That's when the anointing will operate. So, I used to be on a radio station when I first started. As a matter of fact, the Lord told me to stay on there, but I had so much schedule because I started going to school, you know, to Bible college. It's like, you know, university, global university, it's called, and from Assemblies of God. And then I was doing lots of things. I was working full time. I had my great great aunt that I took care of, and all these things. And my schedule was way way overloaded. I was even working overtime, and I was ministering. I was starting three churches at the same time. One Friday night, one Saturday night, one Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, and then I was even visiting churches on Sunday morning and preaching here and there, at different places, doing revivals and all this stuff. So anyway, not to talk about myself, but just give you an example, and I just could not do the radio station, and that was Sunday, like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. After that other church service was 2:30, and then about 4:30 to 6, I'd be up at the radio station every Sunday, and there were other people. There were these groups of singers who went there, and then they would let me preach on there. They would buy, you could buy a 30-minute time slot. Anyway, there were people that, and I had a 30-minute time slot. So, of course, I didn't really sing. As you guys know, you heard me, I don't really sing. And I definitely didn't sing then, not in public. Only since I've been on YouTube, I sing in public. Just as the Lord has given me, you know, I don't care what people think. I'm just singing for the Lord. I know it's releasing the anointing. Even though I can't really sing, the Lord is using me to release that anointing. And it's also just to show you that it's the thoughts and intents of the heart, the attitude of the heart, and it's not the natural talent that God seeks. It's the heart and the humility and the desire to please God and to serve God and bring glory to His name. That's what God loves. That's what God honors. And not our ability to perform in our natural born talents. Even though it's not, that's awesome. But to do it just by grace alone, by faith alone, and not in our own capacity and capabilities. So anyhow, people judge, as Jesus said, we need to learn to judge rightly. Don't judge according to the flesh, but judge according to righteousness, Jesus told the Pharisees. So anyway, I used to let those Southern gospel singers, that's what they were, almost all of them, I would let them sing on my radio show, and then they would sing on theirs, and a lot of them, they didn't like to preach, but they would. If I was there, they'd say, "Hey, Brother Patrick, can you preach on my radio show?" Like the last 5 minutes or 10 minutes, they would sing. Then I would preach for like 5 or 10 minutes, then they would sing some more, you know. And then so we worked as a team. All these different singers, and I was really the only preacher that was there because I was new, you know, and I was practicing preaching. I was new. And so I was happy and so excited anywhere that I could preach. I don't care if it was standing up on top of my head, I would preach 10 times a day, 7 days a week, whenever the Lord opened a door. I still do that. God opens a door. And so anyhow, you know, I was born to do it by the grace of God. And so anyway, at that time I was new, so I was just practicing. And they were, you know, singing for me. Anyway, this one group come in, an elderly family. I think their name is the Sunrise Trio, if I remember correctly, S-O-N. I believe that was them. It was three elderly people. A man and two women. They were siblings, a brother and his two sisters, and they sang. It seems like it might have been the Sunrise Trio. Anyway, they came in singing this song called "They're Holding Up the Ladder That I'm Climbing On." It goes like this: "They're holding up the ladder that I'm climbing on. I'm climbing up the ladder and I'm going home. At the top of the ladder, what joys there will be. The angels are holding up this ladder for me." And then it goes on and on. "As I climb this gospel ladder, heeding every sign, I'm on this gospel ladder. Get on this gospel ladder. Don't be afraid to climb at the top of the ladder." And I don't know all the words. I never heard it before at that time. And of course, I'm not singing it like they were. But their anointing, what I'm trying to get at, is I wasn't expecting but just a Baptist church anointing, which is like 10%. And I'm just being honest with you guys who are spirit-filled people, you know what I'm talking about. It's anointing. This Holy Spirit is there, but it's like 10% of what you would experience in a spirit-filled church. It's just an earnest of the presence of God you would feel from spirit-filled church. But it's the self-same Holy Spirit of God. He's just bound, or, you know, it's quenched. The Bible says, "Quench not the Spirit of God," 1 Corinthians chapter 14. You know, and so a lot of times in these churches where it says right in that same text, "Forbid not the speaking of tongues." When you go to these churches, they forbid the speaking of tongues. They quench the spirit. They grieve the spirit. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, the Bible says. So when you do all those things, you know, God is grieved and he's quenched and he's only moving so much. Even as it says in the Gospels, I don't remember the Bible verse right now, in the Gospels, I wish I could because it's important for denominational people to hear. It says when Jesus went to Nazareth, where he was from, the people were in such disbelief. And they even wanted to throw him off the top of the crest of the hill and kill him. And it said Jesus could do few miracles there because of their unbelief. Except or save heal a few sick folks, it says. That's almost the exact words that it used. I believe that's in Mark. But anyhow, you can always Google that. Jesus could do few miracles there because of their unbelief, except for heal a few sick folk, and that's in Nazareth where he was grew up at. You know, and he said, you know, a prophet is without honor, you know, among his own people and in his own place. But anyhow, so those people sang, brothers and sisters, and the Spirit of God fell in that radio studio. We were in the room, you know, with you broadcast. We were in the room with the microphones and all that. They were singing, and there was like benches in there because they would have all kinds of stuff. Like they do this thing too, where they have this bell that you ring, and they have a preaching marathon, and I forget what you call it. But anyway, they would, after you preach for a while, they ring a bell, and then another preacher gets up there. Then you preach for a while till they ring the bell, then another gets up there, and you do it. I forgot what, I guess it's, I don't remember what they call it, but it's a marathon of preaching. You know, this old school stuff, brothers and sisters. And that's how we get God to move. That's why they call it the Bible Belt. That's why, you know, in the old days, this was one of the, you know, most anointed places of God in the world, is the Bible Belt of the United States, because of things like that, you know, tarrying for the Lord and all these kind of things. But anyhow, the Spirit of God fell in there so much. I mean, I put me, you know, I had to get down, take off my shoes, because it was holy ground. It's the most, I guess it's still to this day, probably the most mightily I'd ever seen God move, experienced. And there was even a feet washing that took place in the radio station that day, several people. And a lot of you guys, you know, you might not know anything about that. Well, you know, there's some churches where they do feet washings, but one of the things that you'll see when the Spirit of God does move, particularly in your, you know, in the, you know, rural southern churches, sometimes there'll be spontaneous thing where people they'll do have a foot washing in the church. And this is, a move of God that brings humility to the people. This is a way that God would move, by this act of washing people's feet. And it just happens spontaneously. I've seen it at least, you know, 3 or 4 different times in churches in the Appalachian region of North Carolina, where, you know, this would be a spontaneous move of the holiness of God and humility upon the people. And they would wash people's feet and all this, unplanned, unscheduled. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I've already been talking, of course, as the Lord led me. You know, it's also, this FYI, I used to have a great-grandmother who was in what they call the Primitive Baptist, and they used to have a feet washing all the time, but they had it scheduled, unlike this spontaneous thing by the move of God I'm talking about. And they used to meet just once a month, all day. I think on a Saturday, they would just meet once a month, and they would stay at church all day instead of just a couple of hours, and they would also have a foot washing and all this, and no instruments and this kind of a thing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I just want to get on here. It's supposed to be a short video. You know me. And just give you this word from the Lord and release this spirit of peace. And it's all about, being a humble, submitted vessel, brothers and sisters. That's where the anointing is. You know, when I make these videos, it's from the Lord. And, it's a mentorship. It's teaching, brothers and sisters. You know, I know that God is using me, and what I want to do is to help you. Well, for me, I want to bring glory to God and do the Lord's will. So, but what God wants, what the Lord wants, for those who'd watch my videos from the Church of the Firstborn and all that, God is looking for people, you know, who he can use, you know, vessels, as the King James says, meet for the master's use, M-E-E-T, you know, or M-E-T, it's not like a meat that you eat, but prepared for the master's use. He wants us to be vessels of honor and not dishonor. And so to become a vessel of honor, you know, it's like that to become gold, a vessel of gold and not a vessel of wood. You know, we have to submit ourselves to the potter. You know, we are the clay and he's the potter. If you go back there and Google and go read, I want you to, this is what I'd ask you to do. Go Google, and I believe it's in Jeremiah. I know it's in Jeremiah. Go Google where God sends Jeremiah to the potter, and it's the potter's wheel is what they call it. You know, maybe if you have a Bible with a chapter headlines, it'll say the potter's wheel. And you will see where Jeremiah went to the potter's house, and he watched the potter making the clay, and if the pot wasn't right, he would crush it and remake it and crush it and remake it and crush it and remake it. And that's what God was giving that lesson. So you probably heard, if you've been doing hearing lots of preaching, you probably heard talking about real pastors, not YouTube videos about dreams and visions. I'm talking about real preaching, mentorship, teaching. I'm talking about real Bible teaching and discipleship, not running to and fro, trying to calculate the rapture and the tribulation. That's not preaching. Anyhow, I know this is what the Lord wants you to do. The Lord wants you to become a humble vessel. More humble. You might say, well, Brother Patrick, I'm humble. Well, the Lord wants you to be more humble. You can never be, to say, oh, I'm already humble enough. I mean, think about it. Ironically, it's kind of an arrogant statement. I mean, you know, we can never be too humble. If you're really so humble, you wouldn't say, oh, I'm already humble enough. See, I mean, think, just think, you know. Think about it. Oh, it's just so easy if you think about it. It's just so simple. You know, God uses the simple things to confound the wise. You know, and so brothers and sisters, we're all the same. Of course, myself included. Whenever I preach, I'm always preaching to the choir. It's for me just as much as anybody else. I'm just a person like you. I'm just a Christian like you. So when I hear myself speak and the Lord is using me, then, I'm just as surprised to hear it as you are. 99% of the time, and 99% of the time, I don't know in advance what I'm going to say. I know a little bit, then when I start going with it, then it changes, you know, and it's a whole lot better than what I was thinking about, you know, 100 times better. You know, so praise God, brothers and sisters, and I thank the Lord. But I don't think, like I said, there's not many, I mean, there's lots of churches where the pastors are, many churches where the pastors are, you know, speaking the wisdom of God and all this, but on YouTube, there's not that many. And so I would say that it's a blessing because I don't see a whole lot of other, you know, pastors on YouTube exclusively making videos for YouTube. You know, a lot of times maybe they record their sermons, whomever, famous preachers on television and all that, they also load their sermons on online. That's just making this for discipling the servants, the Christians, the servants of God. Most of the videos on YouTube you see are not pastors, but people making videos of dreams and visions and all that. There's nothing wrong with that. That's not discipleship. That's not growing you in the Lord. People need to grow in the Lord. They need to be discipled. And that's why all these people fall away when we thought the rapture was going to happen, that it didn't happen. And that's why people are ready to quit. They grown where they were to fall away because they're that, like that seed. That's a, I'm starting a whole other message. How about that? It's the seed that fell on rocky ground. You know, you need that seed to fall on good soil. And so when I start stomping on people's toes and preaching hard, preparing the soil. You know, my grandfather was a farmer, and I used to help him when I was a kid. Every summer, we stayed up there and went to vacation Bible school because my parents didn't go to church, but my grandmother always took us to vacation Bible school every summer. We stayed up there and learned how to milk the cows. My grandfather had a dairy farm in Virginia, in the mountains of Virginia, and I learned how to do all that stuff. But the thing that you do, you know, before you plant your corn and all that, you have to till, so you prepare the soil. So what preaching does sometimes is till the soil. And a lot of times when I'm preaching hardcore, people get mad. Some people get mad, some people get glad. I'm tilling the soil. And a lot of people, they're so rocky-hearted, they can't receive it. They get mad. I'm not on here to win a popularity contest. I'm not on here to have, you know, a million subscribers or whatever and be cute and funny and entertaining. But to make disciples of people. And you know what I mean? And I say it all the time, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I'm just on here to please the Lord, and that's it. And I love all you guys. And it has been a blessing. It is a blessing when people, you know, say, well, thank you, Brother Patrick, and say, you know, we love you, Brother Patrick. We appreciate, you know, your videos. It's been an impact in our lives. That's a huge encouragement. You know, I'm not, you know, I didn't have that before, and I was already doing it going forward just out of sheer will to please the Lord and by His grace, by Him carrying me along by His Spirit. But it does make it easier road when people will, you know, let you know. So I appreciate all the people that comment on my videos, all the people let me know and say thank you and things like that. Though, you know, I would have, you know, not thought that would be a help, but it is. It is a blessing and it is a help to make you keep pushing through. You know, sometimes you feel like quitting. Of course, it should always be for the Lord, but, you know, sometimes it's hard to do it just for the Lord. And then when, you know, when you think about the people that message you, that like some of you guys I've met, and then I think about, well, you know, what about this person, you know, and the videos that I made was a blessing to them, and, you know, so I'm going to keep going on and keep pressing forward for the Lord, for the benefit of the, you know, the people who I've met and who I know and who comment all the time and talk to me, message with me. It's an encouragement. So anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, my videos are always long. I try. But I love all you guys, and I appreciate all you guys. I can't thank you all enough. I made a mention in the video. Let me say this on here since I stopped teaching here, preaching or whatever. I mentioned it in the last video. The Lord has told me to go ahead and go to the Philippines before the November is over with. So I got to put all my stuff in storage and do all that. And that's a whole bunch of mess right there. So, you know, dealing with all that, brothers and sisters, is how many times have we moved? It gets old. I've got to return the car that someone let me borrow. So ask you guys to pray for me about that. I guess I'll be renting a car until the time we leave at the end of November. So anyhow, I guess that's the plan, because if I try to buy an old car, you know, where am I going to put it when I go to the Philippines? You know, then you it might get, if you let it sit for 3 or 4 months, you know, the tires might go flat and all that. And then, you know, keeping insurance and all that, it's not really worth it. The only thing that would be worth it is someone loans you a car or a rent a car. As far as I can see, that's the only solution, as opposed to buying one. If I'm going to be gone 4 months is the time we're going to be in the Philippines. And so anyway, I'm not going to come to Florida, brothers and sisters. I'm sorry, I don't think I'm going to have time. And it doesn't look like I'm going to have time to get to Dallas, even though I want to go to both of those places. So I'll be going straight to Vancouver from here. To Vancouver, the last week of November, I will be in Vancouver and Squamish and Vancouver, Canada. And then from there, straight to the Philippines. I'll be in the Philippines from the last day of November until the beginning of April. And I'll be back, and I'm planning on coming back to Dallas at that time, Lord willing, to Dallas and then to Florida next spring. So brothers and sisters, I should pray about those things and pray for the orphanages. I got to go there, get some new house parents for orphanage number 3. Ask for your prayers about that. And we've already added one, you know, new orphan to orphanage number 4. And orphanage number 4 is doing good. So I want to increase to about 10 orphans there. So I ask you to pray that the kids who are orphans that need a place, we'll be sent to, you know, God will connect them to us so we can get the orphanage up to full capacity. Orphanage number 3, I got to start all over again, get new house parents, and then, you know, just start with one or two, like 2 kids, and then see how it goes. Say a 6-month trial like I've done this with orphanage 3 and 4. 4 did great, 3 did not. So, you know, that's how it goes. And so we pray that the Lord will send us the right house parents and all those things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know me, keep going. God bless you guys.